Happy Friday. This is the Doubleheader. I'm Christina Bellantoni, political editor here at the NewsHour, filling in for Hari Srinivasan. So happy to be here with David Brooks and Mark Shields.
Thank you, Christina. You're 6'2 today.
I think I am a little higher than you.
Just noticed that, yeah.
I did not rig that at
you
all.
You are a superwoman. I know that.
Michelle Obama.
Yes,
exactly. So we are here to talk about the sport of politics first. Rick Santorum sort of emerged today. He spoke at CPAC in Chicago and said, you know, I do support Romney, which we already knew in an email, but he talked about he's going to launch a new super PAC. So is this a vice presidential audition? Is this a just trying to be influential? I mean, how much does he matter when it comes to the presidential election?
He can dream. His chances of becoming a vice presidential nominee somewhere less than his, or I'll have another. I would say...
we'll get to that, yeah.
So you want a candidate who has no negatives, especially if you're basically tied with the incumbent. And Rick Santorum has some negatives, and so he can try and he can be active. You know, let's face it, he had a good year. He vastly outperformed. He ran a good campaign, raised some good issues, so he should be active. He should be involved. But he's not going to be the vice president.
No, he will not. He will not be on the. He won't be on the long list or the short list. He doesn't.
He won't even be in the phone book.
He isn't what Governor Romney is looking for.
Do you think that conservatives look to him for guidance on anything? I mean, he did seem to galvanize a movement, but is he really the top conservative that people would look to?
I think no question. I mean, most people who run for president leave embarrassed, diminished, in some cases humiliated. And I don't have to name names here. We just go through who's run. Rick Santorum was quite the opposite. I mean, he did exceed expectations. He did demonstrate a capacity to go into a state out-resourced with less time and fewer name endorsers and to do very, very well. And he became the conservative, the cultural, social conservative candidate in this race. And there was a real competition for that distinction.
I wonder if that slot will continue to exist because it existed with Romney because he's from Massachusetts and all that. But if you got a campaign next time with a Marco Rubio or Bobby Jindal, I'm not sure you'll have that classic breakdown between the mainstream Republican and the social conservative.
There's more homogeneity.
Right.
I will say this, Christina, that the candidate who was most impressive this week was Jeb Bush, who, in a burst of unvarnished candor, said, I should have run this year. And he should have. I mean, but usually people deny that. No, all sorts of. But I give him credit for saying it. And this was probably his best chance.
Yeah,
well, that's a very interesting question. I have a feeling we're going to be talking about him more than once. And we all know sort of the history with the Bush family. And a lot of people thought that he should have run even several cycles.
You think he'll challenge President Romney in 2016?
Well, that's an interesting idea. Yeah. You heard it here first.
Yeah,
it's possible.
I don't think so.
Bush-Clinton. We're going to go back.
So, Mark, you had a column this week about which presidents have been businessmen.
Yes.
And really, when was the last one that was actually a successful businessman?
The last one was Herbert Hoover, who unfortunately was a great engineer, a very successful investment banker, and a marvelous humanitarian who probably saved Belgium from starving after World War I. But he left the nation after one term with 25% unemployment. It's part of this mantra that we need a businessman in the Oval Office. And if you go through businessmen, the only two sitting presidents who have won that office and then been denied a second term in the past 100 years, both were businessmen. Jimmy Carter, a peanut company developer and owner, and George H.W. Bush, who founded his own oil company. And so, great presidents, whether it's Lincoln was a lawyer, or Washington was a general, or FDR was a lawyer.
Washington was a businessman. He had a plantation.
He had a plantation.
Thomas Jefferson had a plantation, a very poorly run one,
by the
way. Maybe being a bad businessman.
Well, the bad businessman was Harry Truman. I mean, the only successful businessman president was the one who ingloriously went into bankruptcy.
Right.
The idea, the talents you need to be a successful president are so different from being a successful businessman where decisiveness and delegation and all the rest of it matter.
Yeah, after that, let me counter that a little in that Romney's a specific sort of businessman, which is he's a consultant. And now what do consultants do? How do they make their money? They do it by picking talent. You really are told that.
You always like that.
Yeah, we do. But it's always been moral and spiritual. Now it's physical. So what Bain did and Boston Consulting, they decided that the real key to succeeding was in picking really smart 22-year-olds and 25-year-olds.
So that's what you're
going
to do.
So it's
like
picking
Facebook,
talent.
Right?
Yeah. No. And so I would give him. I would say he didn't run a corporation. He knew how to pick talent, and I think that's a skill that may translate a little more than, you know, thinking you can give orders. And I will say the worst senators, we've talked about this in the past, are surgeons and airline pilots, because they are blessed with enormous confidence and the willingness to give orders, which in the Senate nobody listens to.
That's a good point.
I think John Glenn and John McCain were both distinguished public
okay,
servants.
That,
yeah, and they're both pilots, but
okay.
That's okay. So there goes Brooks theory number 1107 just got a hit.
That was my Bill Frisch theory.
I know it was. I know you were trying to broaden it beyond Bill Frisch.
Yeah. Data now, set of one is a perfectly good data set.
Turning to the politics of sport, this is usually a fairly cheerful segment, but I'm going to start off with the sad news and end with the happy note.
Okay.
We all were holding out hope that we would have our first Triple Crown winner since 1978 and him. It's not going to happen. They
retired
today. He had a foot injury.
Oh,
he's going to retire. We will have more about this on the NewsHour Friday night.
Okay.
And but we do have the Belmont Stakes field
sure.
in your hands here. Now, none of us have the best record in picking horses.
No.
And obviously,
no.
I'll Have Another was the favorite, both spiritually and emotionally. But I have to say, Union Rags did well in the Derby. A lot of people liked him. I'm going to go with Union Rags.
Okay, that's good. That's a Union pick. It's been a bad week for Union,
yeah.
So this will pick them up.
It was a labored pick.
It's a labored pick. I have a choice because there are two which are close to my high school nicknames. Unstoppable U was my high school nickname at the prom. And Optimizer is close to, it was actually Breathalyzer, but it's close. But I'm going to go with Unstoppable U.
It's a good one.
I hate to do this, but Unstoppable U, I'm going for it because I like alliteration. And that's as close to alliteration as I can find on this list. But I like the name Painter, too, because it's misspelled. Either that or it's an act of great ego.
They're good
ego.
At that when it comes to these races. Now, I did make a show bet the last time we talked about our Preakness ones, and I did well. So I'm going to say if you want to put $20 on my Adonis, I like long shots. So we'll see
oh,
how that
Oh, really?
Another of my high school nicknames, actually.
Oh, there you go. We'll have to turn to that. Now, to end on a happy note, you know, I thought about, well, President Obama honored the New York Giants at the White House today, but that's not good for me since the 49ers were not actually there. So, after we closed last week, you obviously had this amazing no-hitter with your Mets.
Yeah,
very
right.
Beloved. Now, am I right that Johan Santana is pitching against the Yankees tonight?
He is pitching tonight at the Yankee Stadium. If he no-hits them, I will be a very happy man. It's remarkable. The New York Mets have had amazing pitchers throughout the years. Tom Seaver, Nolan Ryan, Dwight Gooden. It goes on. David Cone. And many, many of them have pitched perfect games after they left the Mets.
Hmm.
And so this was the thing about the franchise. They just was a perfect game earlier this year by a guy who was drafted by the Mets and was terrible for them and now pitched a perfect game. And so this was sort of like a moral thing. And the other good thing about it, the Mets were a overpaid, morally corrupt team for a number of years. Now they're an underpaid, overperforming team. So this has been a great year in Metsdom, and the Santana thing was a little cherry on top.
David took the Santana marvelous, magnificent experience and managed to make it into a rationalization for abolishing the minimum wage.
I mean,
so if you pay people less, they're going to overperform.
This is why we call it the politics of sport.
If he could do back-to-back no-hitters, he would be the only pitcher in history except Johnny Vandermeer, who did pitch back-to-back no-hitters. Can you imagine that in two separate starts, consecutive starts? If he can beat the Yankees, he's doing God's work.
And I should point out one final thing. Another Mets pitcher, a guy named Ari Dickey, had a very tough childhood, bad career, taught himself to throw a knuckleball. He's pitched 24 consecutive scoreless innings.
Yeah.
It's a fabulous story.
First pitcher in baseball to win 9 games this year.
And he has a book out, so everyone should buy that.
Does he really?
Okay, well, the doubleheader will return on July 6th. Hari will be back. I'm sure he will be very happy to see the two of you, and we will check in on all these picks and see how the Mets are doing. So.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.